So since you worked with gadolinium and you wanted to comment on MRI, what's your comment going forward on, you know, still when we see people present at the meeting, they talk about 10 to 20% using an MRI, for example, to look at the prostate, 10 to 20% of the significant tumors are still missed. Do you feel confident that in the next few years, I don't know what the technology is going to show or how it will advance, that we can bring that number down of missed tumors with MRI, significant tumors that are missed by the machine, bring that down substantially?
You know, I'm not sure. I feel like MRI is a very mature modality. And I'm not sure how much improvement upon where we are is going to happen, if that makes sense. I think people are talking about machine learning and deep learning and artificial intelligence interpretations, but sometimes information is just not there, and that it is just a limitation of the images you get off the scanner. So there will probably be some improvements, but it's not going to be a generational change in the way MRI works coming in the next couple of years. So I would expect it to be fairly similar in the short term. I can't speak to what's going to happen 15 years from now. Things seem to change faster than you think. But I think it'll stick in that realm. I think of MRI, in all honesty, at initial staging, as telling where a urologist where to put a needle.
Do you see PET CT doing some of the things that MRI would do for active surveillance, or in that setting, seeing what's going on within the prostate itself? I mean, you got to admit, the 8 years you've been at UCSF, look how far we've come with PET CT and imaging. Is it possible that 5 years from now, someone asks for a PET CT of some type to determine whether or not they're a good active surveillance candidate?
Yeah. So, I mean, that's a common question people do ask. I'm not totally convinced of it. So the approvals are in patients at risk for metastatic disease. So obviously not active surveillance patients, right? So it's intermediate high-risk patients, you know, Gleason scores, high PSAs, that you wouldn't typically put on active surveillance. There's not a lot of work being done in the active surveillance population. So, you know, I don't think PSMA PET radio tracers are going to get approved with that label. So it's unlikely to be approved in that space. I think PSMA PET's probably slightly better than MRI, but not as much better as you think. We did a study where we did MRI, and, you know, we have a PET-MR, so we compared MRI to PSMA PET, and, you know, it was a slight improvement, but it's like 5% better. It's not, you know, a dramatic improvement, where, you know, it's really expensive, PSMA PET, in the overall world. And so I just don't see it. You know, the active surveillance population is huge. It would cost a fortune to image the active surveillance population with PSMA PET. And it's just such a marginal benefit. I'm not completely sure where it's going to go, but it's definitely something worth looking into. Is it something that we'd want to do? But right now, I don't think we have the data to suggest that we should be doing anything like that.